Hello, good evening students. So in the previous class, we discussed about the applications of biotechnology in the field of medicines. Particularly, we discussed about use of biotechnology in gene therapy and as well as production of insulin. So in continuation with the last class, today also we will discuss another use of biotechnology in the field of medicine. What is that? It is molecular diagnosis. So in today's class, we will discuss about biotechnology use in a molecular diagnosis. So what is the meaning of diagnosis and molecular diagnosis? See, this term diagnosis stands for detection or identification of disease, that you know very well. Nowadays, if you know, having any health issues, go to hospital, doctor will suggest for go for blood sample test or urine test. So usually where we visit for having our blood or urine test, it is a diagnostic center. So in a diagnostic center, we will have our urine or blood tested. And that's why here diagnosis stands for to test. But here along with the diagnosis, there is another term, molecular. Then what is the meaning of this molecular? See, molecular diagnosis means identifying disease by using some of the biomolecules. Okay, so here it is a you can call it as a completely a new technology, and it is a part of biotechnology. And by using this method, you can identify disease. But when we are doing the molecular diagnosis, we are not using the common method. We are using some a new trend, a new methodology where we use biomolecules. You already know what is the meaning of a biomolecules, like a nucleic acid or else protein. So by using such things, if you are identifying a disease, then it is called as a molecular diagnosis. See, if any person is detected with or identified with a disease, then he will go to doctor and doctor will give a treatment. And any treatment, the treatment given by doctor is effective. Under two conditions. What are the two conditions? Early diagnosis and second one is understanding pathophysiology. So here what I have done, I have written that in order to make treatment effective, these two things are necessary. One is early diagnosis and another one is understanding the pathophysiology. So what is the meaning of early diagnosis? If any disease is identified at the early stage itself, okay, then treatment becomes very, very easy and it becomes effective. So basically, if any disease is identified at the early stage only, then treatment becomes effective. A doctor can give effective treatment. And second thing is, when a disease occurs in a patient, a doctor should be able to identify what happening in his body. See, once any pathogen enter into a body, human body, it may cause some changes in the physiology of that patient body. So the change in the physiological process of a patient after the entry of a pathogen is called as the pathophysiology. right? So when these two things occur, treatment become effective. But there is a problem with the nowadays medication. What is the problem? Nowadays, our doctors are suggesting conventional diagnosis methods. Okay, so nowadays our doctors are following some of the conventional diagnosis methods. What is the meaning of conventional diagnosis method? Convention means old method, old practices. So what are the old practices that are being followed by our doctors, or you can say physicians? One is blood sample test, and another one is urine sample test. So nowadays, if any patient going or visiting to a hospital having health complaints, then our doctor will ask for go for blood sample test or urine sample test. But these two are called as conventional diagnosis methods. And by these two methods, you cannot identify disease at an early stage. Okay? So you already know that treatment becomes very effective only when a disease is identified at an early stage. But here it is not happening with respect to blood sample test and urine sample test. So, in order to identify disease at an early stage, instead of blood sample test, instead of urine sample test, we have to go for some other ultra modern method. So what are the other ultra-modern methods or ultra-modern techniques? One, it is PCR. Another one is RNA technology. RNA technology. And third one is ELISA. Right? So these PCR, RNA technology, and ELISA, these are the methods, you can say new methods, that help us to identify disease at an early stage. And these three methods comes under molecular diagnosis. How? If you consider PCR or RNA technology or ELISA, in an early stage, by using the genetic material of the pathogen. Just imagine, there is a person, he got any other disease like AIDS. So in case of a disease like AIDS, identification should occur at an early stage. So how to identify this presence of HIV in a person's body at early stage? By using this one. How? If we are following the ELISA, in an ELISA method, we use the antigen present on the HIV. So antigen is an example for a biomolecule. Or else you take this PCR, polymerase chain reaction. This polymerase chain reaction you already studied in the last chapter. One use of PCR is polymerase chain reaction. One common use of PCR is amplification of a gene. What is the meaning of amplification? Producing multiple copies of a DNA. So in addition to this, PCR is also used to identify mutation. Now question comes, how a mutation is identified by using PCR? By using the gene or the DNA that has undergone a mutation. So DNA is nothing but biomolecule. So basically what I mean to say is, these three methods use biomolecules. That's why the name has given us molecular diagnosis. And these three methods are far better than these conventional methods. And one more thing is, usually a disease in a person is identified only after the expression of symptoms, isn't it? So that's why whenever a person having a health complaints, if he go to doctor, first doctor ask what are the symptoms that you are feeling. Is there any high fever? Is there any headache? Is there any nausea? Like this, he will collect all the information about the symptoms from the patient and he will try to predict what a disease it is. But actually, symptoms are expressed only when the pathogen has multiplied into sufficient number. Say for example, if a person is suffering from typhoid, what is the main symptom of typhoid? It is a high fever. A person will get a high fever because of typhoid only when the Salmonella typhi bacteria has multiplied into a sufficient numbers. But in that condition, treatment becomes very, very difficult. Isn't it? So symptoms in a person having any disease, a disease expresses symptoms only a pathogen when a pathogen multiplies and produces sufficient number. But by that condition, treatment becomes very, very tough. So that's why disease should be identified at a early stage. So these are the some methods we are using to identify disease at the early stage. Now let us see one by one how this PCR, RDNA technology and ELISA is useful in identifying diseases. See, first let us discuss about ELISA. So there is a full form of ELISA. What is that? Enzyme. E stands for enzyme. L stands for link. I stands for immuno. And S stands for sorbent. And finally, A stands for assay. So this is the full form of ELISA. You can expect this for 1 mark. In a theory exam, you can expect the full form of ELISA as a 1 mark. Link, immuno, sorbent, assay. As I said already, this test is mainly used for identifying or for the confirmation of AIDS. So how it is done? What are the steps or process of this ELISA? Let us study with the help of diagram. See, when an ELISA process is started in a laboratory, there will be a small plate-like structure. A name of this is microtiter. Microtiter. This is a microtiter, it is like a plate. It has another name. It is also called as Wells tube. So why the name Wells tube is given? This microtiter plate is having numerous small well-like structures like this. So there will be numerous small well or small test tube like structures are present. Right. So in all these wells, the sample collected from suspected patient is added. So what they will do, if any person is having doubt about the AIDS, when he visits any diagnostic center, they will collect a blood sample. That a blood sample is added into the microwells. Microwells. For our understanding purpose, here I have taken only one microwell, only a single microwell, so that we can understand this process easily. So this is now microwell, or you can say micro test tube. In a micro test tube, sample is collected. Just imagine the sample is collected from an AIDS patient. And what is the meaning of calling a person as an AIDS patient? In his blood, HIV will be present. Isn't it? And HIV is a pathogen. So what it is? A pathogen. What is the meaning of a pathogen? Any disease causing organism is called as a pathogen. There are pathogenic virus, bacteria, nematode. There are so many pathogenic organisms. And very interestingly, whenever any pathogen affects a body, that body is called as a host. Okay? And now what happens? When a pathogen enters into the host body, as soon as it enters into the host body, it produces a chemical. Please listen carefully. Pathogen, when it enters into the host body, it produces a chemical. That chemical is called as the antigen. Right? So what is the meaning of antigen? Antigen is a kind of chemical. It may be protein, it may be glycoprotein, it may be anything. It is a kind of a chemical that is produced by antibody. Okay? So antigen is produced by pathogen. In a response to the antigen, antibody is produced by host. Now these two interact with each other. It is just like a fight. Right? Fight between the two persons, right? So now when there is an interaction between an antigen and antibody, by chance, if antigens are succeeded, they are more in number and they are able to dominate this antibody, that person get a disease. By chance, if an antigen compared to antibody, whatever it may be, here basically antigen and antibody, both are, question was asked in an exam. What is the main principle involved in a ELISA? What is that? Antigen and antibody interaction. An antigen comes from pathogen. It is a kind of chemical. Maybe it is a protein. It may be glycoprotein. It may be polysaccharide. It may be a kind of chemical. And antibodies are from host. And you know that antibodies are also the kind of a protein which are Y-shaped. You already studied different types of antibodies in a chapter of human health and disease, IgA, IgM, IgG, IgE. These all antibodies are present in our blood. When does these all antibodies are produced? Antibodies are produced only when pathogen enter into our body and a pathogen release antigen. And both will interact. That is called as the antigen and antibody interaction. That is the principle we are using in ELISA. We have collected a sample. In a sample, the pathogen is present. Just imagine we have collected a blood sample having a pathogen. And you know very well, when the pathogens are present, what they release? Pathogen release antigen. So here I have made this red color as an antigen. So we have taken a micro title or a micro wells tube. In that we have added a blood sample. And in that sample, pathogens are present, that pathogens have produced an antigen. Now to this, we add antibodies. We take antibodies and we will add that into the sample containing antigen. And when antigens and antibodies are mixed, what happens? There is an interaction. There is an interaction between antigen and antibody. Don't forget, antibody, they are like a Y-shaped, like inverted Y-shaped proteins. They are immunoglobulin. Now there is an interaction between an antigen and an antibody. This is the antibody. And very interestingly, there is one key point. What is that? Antibody that we are adding into the sample, this antibody is linked with one enzyme. We are not just adding only antibody. Along with the antibody, we are adding enzyme. So commonly that enzyme is called as the reporter enzyme. So this reporter enzyme is linked to what? It is linked to an antibody, students. That's why enzyme linked. So what is the name? ELISA, enzyme linked. So where this reporter enzyme is linked? Reporter enzyme is linked to the antibody, and that antibody having reporter enzyme is allowed to interact with the antigen. Now both will interact. See here, antibody, antigen, they are interacting, and there is enzyme. When they are interacting, we add a chemical. What is the name of that chemical? Chromogenic substrate. So when an antigen and antibody interaction is going on, we add a chemical called as a chromogenic substrate. What is the meaning of this chromogenic substrate? Here you see, chromo means color. Am I right? Chromo means color. Genic means what? Producing. So we are adding color producing substrate. So here I have mentioned with the green color. This indicates chromogenic substrate. See how interestingly, when chromogenic substrate is added, this substrate and this enzyme react. They will interact. You studied in a first year chemistry, basic concepts of chemistry. Reactant or a substrate converts into product in presence of enzyme. Now this enzyme reacting with the substrate, when this enzyme is reacting with the substrate, there is a change in the color. There is a change in the color of this sample. Okay? So once if there is a change in the color of sample, then it is 100% sure that sample is having pathogen. Okay, sample is having a pathogen. So this is how ELISA is used. Collect a sample, add that to the micro titer, wells, micro wells or micro test tube. To that add antibody along with the reporter enzyme. Now this antibody reacts with the antigen, right? That is called as an antigen and antibody interaction. While doing so, we are adding chromogenic substrate. This chromogenic substrate would react with the enzyme, the reporter enzyme, turning that sample into another color, different color. By changing the color of sample, it can be assured, it can be confirmed that this sample is having pathogen. If this entire things happen, then you can write positive. If there is, even after addition of chromogenic substrate, if there is no change in the color, then you can assure that the result is negative. So this is how ELISA is used. Okay? But, you know, from exam point of view, from theory examination, they have asked only one question, that is the full form of ELISA. And yes, in one CET, Karnataka CET, they have asked, what is the principle, basic principle involved in ELISA? It is the antigen and antibody interaction. So that is all about ELISA. Now let us discuss about another technique, PCR. So what is the full form of PCR? Polymerase chain reaction. And this method technique you already studied in a previous chapter. PCR was for the first time discovered by a scientist. His name is Kari Mullis. There is a scientist, his name is Kari Mullis. He developed this PCR method. And what is the greatest use of PCR? By using PCR, we can produce multiple copies of a desired gene. If we have a single copy of a gene, any gene, and if we want to produce a multiple copy of that particular gene, we can go for this PCR. Basically, PCR is like a Xerox machine. By the help of Xerox machine, what we can do? If we have only a single copy of in a document, and to produce a multiple copy of that document, we will take the help of Xerox machine. The same way it works, right? And moreover, during PCR, we use a specialized polymerase enzyme. What is the name of that specialized polymerase enzyme? That is called as the TAC polymerase enzyme. TAC polymerase. Okay, this has been asked in our exams many times, more than one time it is asked. And what are this TAC stands for? T for thermos, and AQ stands for aquaticus. So what is this TAC? Thermos aquaticus, name of the bacteria. But it is a one archibacteria, Thermus aquaticus, and from this bacteria, this enzyme is isolated. And what is the greatest of this enzyme? TAC polymerase is temperature. Even at a high temperature also, it cannot be damaged. Right? That is the one greatness of TAC polymerase. Because you know, in this year, sometime we maintain a temperature of 98 degrees Celsius. At this condition, at this high temperature, this enzyme still functional. That is the greatness of this TAC polymerase. Anyhow, you studied already this polymerase chain reaction steps and the requirements in a previous chapter. Here, what we have to identify or what we have to discuss uses of PCR. So, commonly, PCR is used in amplification. Even it is also used for identifying mutation. Mutation. And even it is used for identifying cancer. Cancer can be detected by this PCR. And another one is genetical disorder. Genetical disorders. And naturally, we will get a doubt. Sir, in case of ELISA, it is based on antigen and antibody interaction. And on what basis PCR identify disease? Very simple. If you are using PCR, what this PCR will do? PCR will multiply genetic material of pathogen. Okay? So, say for example, you studied about oncovirus. What is the meaning of oncovirus? Cancer-causing virus, isn't it? So when they enter into our body, doctor or any medical background person, to identify that cancer, he take the help of PCR. How this PCR will helpful for the identification of cancer? It will multiply the genetic material of that virus. Even if the genetic material of virus is present in a small quantity, still it is able to identify. Are able to multiply that genetic material. So that is based on there you can identify disease based on antigen antibody interaction, but here the disease can be identified based on multiplication of genetic material of a pathogen. So this is about the PCR. Now let us discuss another method to identify disease at early stage. So what is another method? It is hybridization method, or say RDNA technology. By using RDNA technology also, you can identify mutation. See, just imagine we have a colony of cells, a group of cells in a culture plate. So we are culturing the cells in a culture plate on a nutrient medium. Now, out of these all cells, few, some of the cells, they have their DNA got mutated. Mutation has occurred here. Now, by just looking at the cells, you cannot identify in which cell mutation has occurred. Isn't it? Because genetic material you cannot see. By just looking at the cells, we cannot identify which cell has undergone mutation. But still we have to identify. We have to find out which cell has undergone mutation. So to find out that, we use probe, right? So students, this term probe is a possible one mark question in a theory examination, probe. So what is the meaning of a probe? Probe, it is a single strand. It is a single strand DNA or else RNA. It could be RNA as well. So probe is a single strand DNA or RNA tagged with radio active element. Right? So this is the definition for probe. So what is probe? It is a single strand DNA or RNA that is tagged with the tag, that means having. It is having radioactive element. Just imagine this is the probe. So it may be single stranded DNA or it may be single stranded RNA. And the DNA or RNA, they have nucleotides. And these nucleotides are having a radioactive phosphorus. Because in a DNA and RNA, phosphorus is present. And when we consider the probe as a DNA or RNA, here in a probe, the phosphorus is present. No, that phosphorus is radioactive. That's why we have mentioned it as radioactive element. Now this probe, we take a multiple copies of probe, multiple copies, and we will add to each and every cell. To all cells, we add this probe. And what is the function of this probe? Basically, when it is added into cell, it enter into the cell, it will get a paired wherever complementary is possible. And it will pair only with the normal gene. Okay? So what is the function of this probe? We are adding a probe into the all cells. And this probe get a pair wherever complementary is possible, that too with the normal gene. So, we have added this multiple copies of probe to each and every cell, and it has paired with all cells. Just imagine here in this cell, it has not paired, right? In this cell. So why here this cell do not allow probe to get paired? Because this cell is having a gene, that a gene is not a normal. If it is having a normal gene, then it could have paired with the probe. Since it is, this cell is not allowing the probe to get a pair, definitely this cell is a mutant cell. By the way, how to confirm whether the cells are having probe pair or not? Very simple. Once this probe is added to all cells, we use a film, thin layer of film. That thin layer of film is called as photographic film. So what we are using here, we are using photographic film. When we are using this photographic film, soon after the addition of probe, first take a group of cells where you want to identify mutation. Culture them on a culture plate, then use a probe, add this probe to all the cells. Probe will get a pair with the complementary genes in a normal cell, and the cell which has undergone, the gene which has undergone mutation, it cannot pair with the pro. As a result, all these cells produce a radiation. That radiation can be identified on photographic field. But this cell is not producing any kind of radiation. Right? Since it is not producing any radiation on the photographic field, you can 100% confirmly say that yes, this cell has undergone mutation. So students, that is all about ELISA, PCR and RNA technology. So by using these three methods, we can identify disease at the early stage. Then it will be very much easier for a doctor to treat the disease. Now, let us discuss the last use of biotechnology given for our cells. We discussed about the biotechnology used in agriculture, medicines. Now, let us discuss the last use of biotechnology, that is in production of transgenic animals. Okay, nowadays biotechnology is widely used in the production of transgenic animals. You can call these transgenic animals as genetically modified organisms. So basically, what is the meaning of this transgenic animals? See here, trans means different. Trans is a different, right? Genic means genes, animals. Then what is a transgenic animals? These are the animals which have some other extra genes along with their genes. Okay, so when any animal having its own genome or genes, along with that, if it is having some extra genes, some foreign genes, then it is called as the transgenic animals, transgenic organisms. In theory examination, they may ask you definition of transgenic animals for 1 mark. So what a definition is given in NCERT about the transgenic animals, these are the organisms that have had their DNA manipulated to possess and express an extra instead of extra, you can write foreign gene. So this is the exact definition of transgenic animals given in our NCERT book. These are the organisms that have had their DNA manipulated. What is the meaning of manipulated here? Manipulated means altered. So if we are having an organism where in that organism we are changing its genetic material, how we are changing its genetic material? By adding extra gene. When any foreign or extra gene is added, its total genome becomes changed. And why we are adding that foreign gene? So that that foreign gene could able to multiply and produce a useful product. In order to understand transgenic animals in a simplest way, just to recall the things you studied about production of insulin. So in the production of insulin, what we did? We took a plasmid. In that plasmid, we inserted a gene that produced insulin. Now that is added into bacteria. So we are adding human gene, that is insulin gene, into the bacteria. Now the bacteria is nothing but transgenic organism. And within that bacteria, our insulin gene express means it produce a desired product. So such organisms are called as transgenic animals, and students, nowadays scientists have produced various transgenic animals. Some of the examples for transgenic animals: mice, sheep, fish, pigs. Okay, so these are the some of the examples for transgenic animals. There are transgenic mice, transgenic sheep, fishes, pigs, and other some other examples are present. And out of all the transgenic animals so far produced, most commonly produced transgenic animal is mice. You know, nearly 95% of transgenic animals, it is mice only. Okay, so nearly 95% of transgenic animals produced, it is mice. Mice, transgenic mice is widely used in the field of biotechnology for the purpose of various experiments. Okay, so this is about the definition and examples of transgenic animals. Now a simple question arises: what is the use? What is the use of producing a transgenic animals? Why we have to produce them? Because there are some of the uses. There are some of uses from these transgenic animals. What are those? Number one, transgenic animals are used in a laboratory to study normal physiology and development. This is the one use of transgenic animals. Second one, to study diseases. Third use, to produce biological products. And fourth use is to test vaccine safety. To test vaccine safety. And finally, the last use of transgenic animal is toxic or chemical safety test. So students, these are the five uses of transgenic animals. In fact, this year in a theory examination, last year theory examination, it was asked for 5 marks. In theory examination, there was a question: write a note on or explain uses of transgenic animals. So you need to mention all these 5 uses along with the explanation, right? So better if we start from the definition. Transgenic animals are the organisms that have their DNA manipulated to possess and express an extra foreign gene. There are many examples for transgenic animals like mice, sheep, fishes, pigs. Among all the transgenic animals, the most commonly used transgenic animal is mice. Nearly 95% of transgenic animals are nothing but mice only. Now, what are the uses of transgenic animals? Transgenic animals are used to study normal physiology and development. They are used for the purpose of studying the diseases. They are also used for the production of biological product. And along with these 3 users, they are being used for the test of safety of vaccines or chemical safety test. Now let us see all these users of transgenic animals one by one. So the first use of transgenic animal is to study normal physiology, physiology and development. So this is the first use of transgenic animals. See, nowadays the scientists are very much interested in identifying or to study about genes, right? How genes are regulated, how these genes are responsible for normal growth and development of body, and how these genes are responsible for normal physiology. Okay, to study how genes are regulated and how they are responsible for normal growth and development of body, and how they control the various physiology, for this study purpose, the transgenic animals are being used. For example, there is a one complex protein called as insulin-like growth factor. Insulin-like growth factor. So what is this? It's a kind of a protein which is responsible for normal development, growth and development of the body, this factor. And scientists want to study how this insulin-like growth factor involved in the development of body. So directly you cannot use a human body for the experiment purpose. So that's why the function or the role of this factor in the human body is studied by the help of transgenic animals. So that is one use of transgenic animals. Now let us see second use of transgenic animals. To study genetical disorders, second use, to study genetic disorders or diseases. This is the second use of transgenic animals. In the students, you study already some of the diseases called as the genetical disorders. In this chapter, Principles of Inheritance and Variation chapter, you studied about a genetical disorder, that there are some disorder that occur due to the defected gene. Okay, so now scientists, they want to know how genes are involved in the development of diseases. Don't think that all genes are good. There are some genes which are very bad. To take our human body only, there is a gene called as the dystrophin gene. I hope you know that. This dystrophin gene should present in a recessive form. If this become dominant, the dystrophin gene become dominant, 100% there is a disorder called as the muscular dystrophy, a genetical disorder. See, genes are not good. All the genes are not good. And there are another set of gene, group of gene called as the proto-oncogenes. These proto-oncogenes are basically inactive form. If they express, they cause cancer. Like this, there are so many genes involved in causing genetic disorders. And scientists, they want to know how genes are responsible for causing genetic disorders. Will it be possible to conduct experiment on human body? No. That's why they are taking the help of transgenic animals. So transgenic animals, they are like a model. What is the meaning of model? If you go to zoology lab and want to study human digestive system, directly you won't cut human body and see the digestive system. For understanding, for a study purpose of digestive system, there will be models, like human digestive system model, circulatory system model. Same way, transgenic animals, they are served as, used as a models. Why? They are used as a model to study the diseases that occur because of genes. The scientists, they want to know how genes are responsible for causing genetic disorders. There are some genetic disorders like cancer itself, cancer, and even rheumatoid arthritis, Alzheimer disease. So these all are the diseases, genetical disorders, and these genetical disorders are because of genes. And scientists, they want to study which gene is responsible for these all genetical disorders. And to study the genes, they are using transgenic animals. So the first use of transgenic animal is they are used to study normal physiology and development. Second use is to study diseases. So once the genes are responsible for disorders is identified, treatment become very easy. So they can think further what are the possible treatment for the genetic disorders. Now the third use of transgenic animals, what is the third use? Biological products. Biological products. What is the meaning of a biological product? These are the chemicals produced by living organisms. So whenever any chemical or whenever any product is produced by the living organism, it is called as a biological product. And in a nowadays case, there are various biological products which are used in a treatment. In medicine field, we are using various biological products to cure the diseases. But there is one problem. What is the problem? Biological products, they are so expensive. Let me give one simplest example. You might have studied about TPA. What is the meaning of TPA? Tissue plasminogen activator. So what is this? Tissue plasminogen activator is a kind of protein. What is this commonly called as? This is commonly called as a clot buster. Clot buster. From where it is produced? It is produced by a bacteria. And it is produced by a bacteria. What is the name of the bacteria? Streptococcus. Am I right? So there is a bacteria called a Streptococcus. This bacteria produces a clot buster or tissue plasminogen activator. What is the use of this? It is used in removal blood clots. This is studied in a microbes in a human welfare chapter. That TPA or tissue plasminogen activator clot buster is used to remove the blood clot. And particularly it is given to the heart patient. Can we call this as biological product? Yes, of course, it is a biological product only. Because it is produced by a living organism, Streptococcus. And it is used in medicine. It is well and good. But what is the problem? It is so costly. So costly. Now what is the solution for this? Make transgenic animals to produce this. So by using transgenic animals, we are making transgenic animals to produce biological product. There is one sheep. There is a sheep called as a Tracy. Okay? What is the name of the transgenic? In fact, it is not a natural sheep. It is a transgenic sheep. What is the name of this transgenic sheep, Tracy? What is so special about this Tracy? In this Tracy sheep, the gene responsible for producing tissue plasminogen activator is isolated from which bacteria? Streptococcus bacteria. TPA producing gene is isolated and it is added into sheep. That's why it is a transgenic sheep. And now this Tracy sheep produces milk. Not just a normal milk, it produces a milk containing what? Containing tissue plasminogen activator. So directly you can collect a milk of a Tracy and can be given to a heart patient. Right? It is called as a coronary thrombosis. Whenever the blood get a clot in the heart, blood vessels, that is called as a coronary thrombosis. Under such condition, you can use the milk of tracy, which contains tissue plasminogen activator. And this tissue plasminogen activator could blast, burst the blood clots. So that is the greatness of transgenic animals. Transgenic animals, they are used in the production of biological product. Another example, in the year of 1997, a cow was produced, a transgenic cow called as a Rosie. This is the transgenic cow. Okay. Now this transgenic cow, Rosie, produced milk. And this milk contained, it is not a normal milk. Of course, all the cows produce a milk, but the milk of a Rosie is something special. Why? The Rosie, which is a transgenic cow, produced a milk. It contains human milk protein. What is the name of that human milk protein? Alpha lactalbumin. So students, what I have written here, there is a one transgenic cow called as a Rosie, which is producing a milk. That milk contains human milk protein. What is the meaning of human milk protein? This alpha lactalbumin is there, no? This alpha lactalbumin is a protein that is present only in a human milk, not in a cow milk. Right? Not in the milk of cows. It is present only in the milk of humans. Okay? But nowadays what happened? There is a reduction, decreasing in the amount of breastfeeding among the population. Right? Nowadays, the modern mother, they are not interested in breastfeeding. Right? Within a span of 2 or 3 years, they will feed their baby with the cow milk. Cow or buffalo milk. But what is the problem with the feeding of this cow or buffalo milk? It do not contain this food. And this protein is very much important for the normal growth and development of a baby. That's why scientists have produced, in order to sort out that problem, scientists have produced this transgenic cow, which is also having alpha lactalbumin. And if you collect 1 liter of milk, 1 liter of rosy cow milk, it contains 2.4 grams of alpha lactalbumin. Okay, in fact, this was asked in examination. A transgenic cow Rosie contains human milk protein dash with a percentage of amount of this much. Okay, so it is another example for the transgenic animal that you can use for production of biological product. Now let us see, there are some sheep's varieties. There are some transgenic sheep's. Okay, and these transgenic sheep's contain anti-hemophiliac G factor. Okay, listen, this is very interesting. There are some transgenic sheep. These are transgenic sheep contain a special gene. Name of the gene is anti-hemophiliac factor. It is the name of the gene. Now, when this gene is present, it produces clotting factor. It produces clotting factor 9. So here I have written a clotting factor 9. What is the meaning of clotting factor 9? It is a protein. Complex protein. This complex protein clotting factor 9, what is the use of this? It is responsible for blood clot mechanism. If this protein is present, it is helpful for the blood clot. But there is one genetic disorder. What is the name of that? Hemophilia. So what happens in a hemophilia? There will be no blood clot. Blood will be continuously flowing. So under that case, you can use transgenic sheep milk. This transgenic sheep contain a gene. This gene is taken from human healthy human cell. Anti-hemophilia factor gene. This gene produces a clotting factor 9 in the milk of sheep. That sheep milk can be used for the person who is suffering from hemophilia. See, these are the uses of the some of the uses of transgenic animals. Still, there are many uses of transgenic animals that we shall discuss in next class. Thank you.